Okay, so there we go. So one of the advantages, of course, of Tegmax is that it's a structured editor. So if you take a typical Tegmax document, let's take one from the help, for instance, then you see that if you go inside some of the structures, then there's a lot of information on this so-called focus bar about the structure of your document, the structure that you're in. So, for instance, here we're inside the section. You can see that here. You can also see it over here, by the way. Here, for instance, I'm inside the description environment, where I can have several tags with explanations of these tags. And here I'm inside emphasize environment. So here you see the different environments I'm in on the bottom line. So I'm inside the description, inside emphasize, and behind a space. Now, you can operate on the most inner environment that you're in, which is also highlighted with the cyan box around here. So you can see the cyan box. The other environments are also visible. So here, for instance, the description environment, but it's just in light gray. And inside this bar, you can find the information about the focus, which is the innermost environment. So, for instance, I can change the structure. So we're currently inside an emphasize, but I can change it, for instance, into an underline or into strong. And I can also navigate. So with these buttons, I go to similar environments. So, for instance, go to the next similar tag to the emphasize tag. So here I have another emphasize tag, here another one, and I can navigate in the document and see all these tags. Go to the last one, go to the first one, which is similar. So similarly for sections, for instance, next section. So I can quickly go through the sections. For the sections, by the way, you also have them here. So here you have the menu with, if you're inside the section, you can just go to section of your choice. And some environments have some additional things. For instance, sections can be numbered or not numbered. So I can remove the numbering of a section or put the number back again. You can also get some help on the current environment. So here you see both, well, all these structured variants being explained, the structured navigation being explained, and you also see the definition. So all these different tags are defined in so-called style files, and the current definition of section. If you ask for the help, then you see the current definition. So this may be seem a bit difficult to understand, but for more easy environments, it can be nice to know how it was defined. You can also delete the current tag. So, for instance, delete the section or move out of it. Right. some of the tags also support still some other things, like for instance, if we have a matrix, then you can insert new rows and columns like that. Okay. If we insert, let's say, a picture, let me insert a picture. So I'm going to make a big figure. I'm going to take a picture from my disk. What do we have as pictures? Unfortunately, this is not. Maybe where can I get pictures? Let's see. Is this? Here we have some pictures. Funk animals. Well, let's see. Wolf. I can put that there. And then with on my laptop, I can use Mac laptop, I can use command and then the arrow keys, for instance, for changing the geometry of this picture. I can also change the width and height. I can both change the width and the height. And also you can also if you have the text here, you can change the position with respect to the surrounding text. Right.
Can you do that for two images in a row, so they don't have to use tables?
Sure. If I take two images, right, I can, for instance, put this one here and put that one there. So this is command page up and page down for me. Now I don't know what it will be for you, but because it depends on the Linux, this will be different, and on the Windows, this will again be different. So by the way, another thing I didn't tell is that in the preferences you can specify a look and feel. So this will specify how your keyboard will work. I use an Emacs like keyboard, but you can use a GNOME one or a KDE one or a macOS or Windows. Okay.
Can this shifting around text and figure be done with a small figure inside text, like a
floating? Sure. If I took a figure and I can put it here, it just works the same, right? That's not a small figure. That's not really a problem.
Wow. Right. I struggled for ages with that.
Okay, and of course you can change it directly here too.
That's what I used to do.
Okay.
You do.
And all this is explained in the manual about. I think it's just editing tools. Editing tools, and if you go to structured cursor movement and structured variants, what I'm saying now, positioning and resizing objects, right?
The documentation would be handy.
Okay.
What's new in documentation?
So in any case, there. That's where it is. Now, of course.
Documents. Then you can.
Now, let's Let's go back to our paper. Oh, by the way, I can try to find back the I have to find them. I think they're. I can. Where? I'm looking for. I'm looking for. Yeah, the point is that in under macOS I cannot see hidden directories. Do you know how to get the .techmax directory?
Mm-hmm.
Command-Shift-G. Ah, great. This should work, right? Okay, good. Because then I can simply go to the scratch and take the one of the ones that we had before, right? Oh, I can... It doesn't... So, G, right. Okay. Let me put it there. Maybe it was this one. No, it was not that one. Okay. Maybe this one. Huh. Not that one either. Maybe it was this one. Oh, this is still another one. This is definitely... Maybe, oh, maybe we still have it, actually. No, I closed it, I think. I already tried 9. Oh, this is another one. So maybe we lost it. Yeah, this was it, right. This was what we were doing this morning, right? So, of course, one of the advantages of structured text is that you can have different styles for the presentation. So here we have a generic text, but we can make an article, in which case we will have numbering of sections here, which gets a bit different. But I could also choose, for instance, one of the Springer journal styles. And then, as you see, the page size get different, the way the abstracts are being formatted is getting different, the way that the address information and authoring information is being displayed is different, and so on. One other thing you can do is changing the language. So for instance, I can choose for my document language, I can choose French, in which case you see that the date is getting written in French, the theorems are getting written in French, proofs are written in French, and so on. And also an interesting thing about the structure inside the document is that, for instance, search and replace is context dependent. So, for instance, if I'm searching for the letter A, then whenever I'm in math mode, I will only find the A's which were also in mathematical formulas. So, even if I had many A's outside, like that, if I'm searching for A's, I will not find the A's which are in usual text. Similarly, if you search for a word in a text which is written in two languages, for instance, then it will only find the text which is in the same language. So these things are context dependent.
For example, you search for string in a normal paragraph, it would be also found inside theorems. Why is the difference?
I guess it checks the intersign.
Oh, it will only be dependent on major changes in environment, the search and replace thing. So mainly language and mode. Not all context changes, because of course if I'm searching for a word, the word D, it might be inside some base text or inside some theorem or somewhere else. So I really want to find all these instances. That you will find, but then you have to mark it up as text. So if I do this and I'm searching D again, it will find these ones, right? That's okay.
This is the last version. There is something we can't do it anymore. Copy the part of text.
Yeah, that has been disabled. So you have to put it back as text. So I can copy and paste some text and put it inside text here. That's okay. But it should have been marked up as being text. Right. I don't insert an invisible text tag inside the mathematics for doing that. And so you also have certain tags where you have some hidden information inside. You can also see those things on the title in this focus bar that you see here. So for instance, one example would be a fault. I will show a bit more of these things later. So here I have some folded structure. So so you can switch between these two possibilities.
Can I do that on the sections, on every structuring thing, or just if I make a forward test?
For the moment, it doesn't work on sections, but you could define a section tag which does that. The point, of course, is that I will come back later to this when we will discuss the Tegmark formats. But many of the bad design decisions inside Tegmark are inherited from LaTeX. And LaTeX, one bad design decision in LaTeX is that sections don't have the body of the section inside the tag. So it means that basically, a section is not really a section, it's just a title of a section. And if you want to make sections foldable, then you of course need another kind of section tag where the body of the section is part of your tag.
It would have to be modifications to begin document, end document.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. You would have to have something like begin section, end section, and things like that. It's doable, but I should maybe have done it right from the start. But as I said, many of the bad design decisions, I took them from LaTeX because I wanted to be compatible with LaTeX, which is reasonable, right? Already in the start, I knew that some of these would probably raise problems, but they got worse and worse with time.
I have a few questions. First of all, isn't it a translation issue? Like, if you had them so-called recursive sections or sections with a body, you could still interface with LaTeX by just changing the import and export thing.
Yeah. Well, it's doable, but it requires some work. And
is it something you would?
It's on the list.
No, there is already something done by the RIS now.
Yeah, I did do something like that, but I have to still think more and experiment more before I can release this for the main public. It's on the list, and indeed, sections we would like to have to be them foldable by default. It would be nicer, actually.
That means that if you were in a section, you have to exit out of a section.
Well, it would be quite useful if I could just click on the one here, and that would basically fold the section.
Yeah, I understand that, but that doesn't require that the section, the body of the section be inside the tag.
Right.
Isn't that a consequence of doing that? It would be that if you were in a section, you create another section, it would be create a subsection.
Yeah, that would be in the other kind of thing, is that in LaTeX, you have section, subsection, subsection, and all these things are different tags. What would also probably be more logical is that there's just one section tag, and that if you have a section with a body, that if there's a new section inside, that basically it would automatically select a subsection. Right.
That's just for styling.
Yeah.
H1s and then subsections and then have subsection stars inside. But what you showed here for the abstract is that's one thing that you just wrap around something. Nothing would stop us from using a folding thing for the body of the section that just evaporates when converting to text.
You can
always
take one line, the whole place.
I can expand more on this issue, but right. Anyway, so there are other tags like cite, for instance, if I want to cite some text, and you see here that some of these things are invisible. Once you activate this tag, there are several states, the activated states, where you can see the names of the citations themselves. I can give a more the example, for instance, from here, right? So here you see how the citations look like, and here you see also the labels of the citations themselves. So I can modify this invisible information, which I can modify it in the focus bar. I can also open up the thing. So if I push this button, I basically change the state of this citation to an inactive state, where I can edit the contents of the tag directly and put it back. Activated. Okay, so these are some of the main structured tools that one can use. So let me quickly discuss some of the editing things still with a bit more things. So for instance, tables. So we can make several times of tables. Here we make a table with some borders. So there are a few things that many users typically would like to do. It's like making, for instance, a table which spans over the whole paragraph width. So you have a special item for this here. And so I make a table with several lines and with several columns. Another thing you might want to do, for instance, is making, let's say, a table where I have some things. Of some strange animals, right? And then I would like to put some big description here. Okay, but then you see when I start to do that the thing, it expands forever. So I would like to enable line breaking in some of the cells. So you can do that by just selecting the cells on which you want to have line breaking, and then select the line wrapping item here. And now, now I have this thing enabled. So I can put just multi-paragraph text content inside these cells.
Can you comment on the rationale of having by default non-hyphenable cells instead of, you know, like you could switch the other way around? You could have by default cells where you can, where there is hyphenation.
Yeah.
And do the other thing, explicitly turn it off. Why is it like this? I think a lot of people are surprised by this.
Oh, well, for a matrix, typically you would like to have the thing not, and also it depends. It really, in my opinion, it's not clear that making things hyphenatable by default is really the right default option. That's not clear, actually.
I think the problem is when you have the table that's going to be on the bounds of the page, so you never want that. So if it's just for a beginning of the page, then you want to hyphenate it, but probably not how to.
And
how do you think you can hyphenate it? So the problem is that when you have many columns, how do you compute the size if everybody is hyphenated? You know, you have a problem to decide what to do. If you have two columns which are hyphenated, how do you
decide? Yeah, but it's a solution that is you can actually never to do that in some other place. You can actually do that.
So let me select hyphenation for everyone, right? For instance. This would what would happen. Right. So of course then of you can select the width and height.
You can tune it.
Yeah. Nevertheless, it's not clear for me that people want line wrapping by default. That's not clear.
People make a poll. I find myself all the time activating it.
Yeah, I activate it on
myself
too.
It's kind of super.
But you don't want the table to get bigger than the page. Whenever that happens, you have to write it. What would be the alternative?
Well, it gives you some. Let's say. Let's say that hyphenation also presupposes that your table has a width. Okay, and what is the width of your table? So here I took a table which had a width which is one paragraph, but if I take just insert any table. I start a new table, then by default, my table, when it's as long as it's small, it doesn't have a width.
It's reasonable. Once it hits the border, you turn it.
Right? So I can even imagine a situation that I have two or three tables here. Okay, so now if I have two or three tables, what would be the typical size that I should have for these tables? What would be the size of... What should be the width? At which point should I start to hyphenate this thing? If hyphenation was turned on here.
Initially, the first table, you had a width at first, and then by typing, you caused the table to disrespect the width that it's given.
Yeah, but here there is no width given.
Right, so there that's a different situation.
So basically the width extends forever, even if, though I specified hyphenation, right? Because I didn't give any width. So what would be the width? Should it be one paragraph? Should it be half of a paragraph? I have different tables on the thing, on the line. For me it's not clear what actually would be the Yeah, the algorithm for...
You decide to hyphenate that word underneath the table. F-I-U-W hyphen.
Yeah, but that's because it's outside the table, right? It's not, it's just...
The table is also outside your table.
But the table, the table doesn't, it cannot get hyphenated because it's inside the box, right? But... But now you see the point here is that if I really would like to have things hyphenated well, the width of this table would go from the start here to the end of the line. But then it interacts with the general hyphenation of my paragraph. And that's quite nasty, because it would suffice that I type something here and the width gets different, right?
Yes,
so this is not a structured way of computing width anymore. So basically, as soon as I specify a well-defined width for my table, it can be a reasonable default option that things get all hyphenated at this width. But as long as I didn't specify, for a matrix, for instance, you don't specify a width.
But a matrix is a matrix, not a table. So it's a table, but it knows that it is a matrix.
Yeah, but you can also have small tables inside text. I mean, there's no reason that this is only for mathematics.
That sounds like a good suggestion that you make, that if the table has a width, then it should be respected. If it doesn't have a width, that should also be respected. But it means something different, right? Because there's lots of little spiders running around here. So if you specify width, then in order to obey what you've said, hyphenation is somehow required, or folding. Line wrapping is required.
Not necessarily. You may also typically want precisely that some text gets superposed with some neighboring items, just because it depends. In any case, here you see how currently it works.
One question. In this case, third thing that can happen is not that mid-long table should not be put on its own line, should there not be a line break immediately before it. If you have a long sentence and then a really long table, should that table be moved down to the next line? So shouldn't there be a line break right before that long table? Shouldn't that paragraph?
Here, you mean? Probably yes. In this case, yes, I guess so. And that's a bug probably. The point here is that the tables by default are maybe understood as. Oh, here it does it. Yes, as soon as the width gets large, smaller than one paragraph, then so it understands that this. should be the behavior, but I can try to dig this up. But of course, this situation basically already is an error situation somehow. So maybe I don't treat the error well here, but nevertheless, it's already.
Well, here I see a solution, because when you take out some of the text, that looks. Sort of correct. If you expand it a little bit more, maybe it should just hyphenate once it gets past one paragraph.
Right.
So I guess the question is, how does text mass avoid overflow boxes?
It usually should always hyphenate as much as possible. But in the case of tables, things are a bit more special, because the width of the table, once again, may not be well specified at all times. It gets specified at a different moment. And so maybe the hyphenation is done before that the actual width of the table gets known. And in this case, this is because of this, the table which has a bad width. So it probably is a bug, but okay. As I saw, you can also one other interesting thing of TechMax is that you can specify properties on subtables. So for instance, you can specify that these cells here have to have a certain background color. Okay. Or that in this column things have to be, let's say, right aligned.
And if I want to join all these four cells into one cell, is it possible?
You cannot join the four cells into one cell, because joining is not maybe very well defined either. What you can do, on the other hand, is having cells with a certain span. So I can ask this cell to have a span of 2 in this direction, and I can also ask this thing to have a span of 2 in the row direction. So that you can do. And this is also something which is not supported in LaTeX, for instance.
Okay.
Some very special packages which probably will break in combination with other packages. At the moment I implemented this thing, it was not standard in LaTeX. But maybe it since then LaTeX also.
Here we see a convention that when you merge the, when you made the span, it went for the next row, right?
Yeah.
So this thing is that I think it's representative of general techmaxes could have some defined behaviors for things that sometimes you say are not well defined, but you define them by so for example if he wants to merge all four and selects them as a unit.
That would be a nicer interface that you could just select thing and then say join or something like that. That could be done indeed. It would be probably a nicer interface, right? So that's tables, and then yeah. So you already saw some images. You can also draw some images yourself. So there's a. So there's a integrated drawing facility. So here we selected that, and you can just pick some of these tools. For instance, let me draw a polygon. Right, you can just draw this. You can select parts of this thing. I can select a point and just move it around again. You can also put something on the edge. Insert a new point.
It's working
a bit better. Huh? Yeah, it's working a bit better than before.
Yeah, it's very good.
And
I did it.
Yeah, the old implementation, there were many bugs inside. So I started cleaning up this code and actually rewriting it. It's not finished yet. So it's a bit better than before, but there are still many things which have to be changed for it to be really good.
Part of it is
written in Scheme and part of it is written in C++. The rendering is written in C++. But the editing is written in Scheme.
So in theory, you could programmatically do this.
But the Scheme, the old code was really quite horrible, actually. So I really had to rewrite the Scheme code. The Scheme was written like C, and that's not how you should write Scheme.
Is it possible that if you open a Scheme session, you manipulate these objects interactively?
Yeah.
Because this would make for a great tutorial of starting with Scheme and Techmax.
Ah.
Create a circle, manipulate it, because
self-control DRG that did that. So you have to actually write scripts of the Scheme.
Here, in Techmax.
There was a plugin that I dealt with that's not too low. And you can do that in Techmax. So if you Google Dr. Geo Techmax plugin, you'll see something like that. So you can write, you can do a session, a Dr. Geo session in Techmax, write Scheme code, run it, run set it DRGO, you can manipulate interactively the figure, and then when you're ready, you can print the image into text mask back again.
Maybe you can show us this. Right, that would be nice to see.
Yeah, because I actually helped cleaning that. I didn't do anything. Henry Hilaire Fernandez did it. I just put a name.
So
it's very easy because
that's one of the things I'm missing is whenever you start with a scheme in TestMask, it's not clear how to follow a normal scheme tutorial, but use objects from the tree or from the graphics. This would be really amazing as a tutorial for what you can do with the scheme.
Why did you choose a transparent mode for the figures?
I did some.
Is this new?
The point is that's in the debug. I put alpha transparency here, so you have to select the debugging tool first, and then in the debug menu in the experimental you will select the alpha transparency. And why did I not put it in the main version? That is because PostScript does not support this, and you have this PDF marks in PostScript that you can put for when you convert to PDF that it should recognize this alpha transparency, but basically this is implemented in no of the PostScript renderers that I know of. And GoScript, for instance, does implement this thing for hyperlinks, but not for alpha transparency. So basically I can draw my figures like this, my pictures like this, but if I wanted to print them, I would not get the same thing on my output, which is kind of a pity.
Can you compute the color that results from the transparency, and that's what you put in the PostScript?
I guess everything just works, but everything works on my screen, but it does not work in the PDF. Nor in the PDF.
Because the PDF is produced from the
PS.
There is bottleneck.
Right. And so another thing I can show is, you can write directly, of course, math formulas. Oh, now you see I still have this alpha transparency, so I will put back 100%. So I can put some things there, right? And another thing you can do now is select some arrow mode, and the points, as you see here, are somewhat sticky. So around the text here, I have 9 spots which can be used as indications where you can typically put an arrow. So this can help you to quickly make some diagrams. Okay.
Is it on how many pages of JPEG topology we have there?
Oh, okay. Let me take.
Then they remove just a single object, and if you just change one of the vertices, the rest of the arrow will be.
No.
So if you move A out of its position right now, what will happen?
It won't work.
Okay.
So can you, even if you didn't want to, let's say the arrows to stretch, you just want to group the whole thing, that whole cluster of objects together?
That is possible. Then you have to use grouping. So you would just let me see. Now the question is on this Mac keyboard, how does that work? Wait a minute. This I should have a right arrow button. I have it at home, but oh, here it is. With Control, I can do that. Okay, so now I have this thing, and I say group. Oh no, this was not this one. Oh, I just have to click probably on it. Right. So now it's a group. But if I go back to the main mode, let me see. Where is the handle? I don't have a handle. Okay. Then I have to select moving here, and I can just move this.
The whole thing will be moved as a single object. You cannot really change the relative positioning of the vertices, right?
You want to do interactive geometry.
Like with you.
No, I plan to have these things. I did start doing some things to make that possible. The point is, as I said, that a lot of this old code is really obsolete, and I first have to completely clean up this code before I can go the full way to interactive geometry.
I have to apologize. You're showing us cool stuff, and of course, being creative set of minds, we would like it. Stuff, so you provoking
us. Yeah. So it somehow is on the list, but it's not. It's for the moment. This is not done.
Once you show that you have an adhesive spots where you can park the origin or the end of your error, immediately someone can assume that you can change the nodes, move them around, and
right.
The error still stick to them.
Right. So that indeed I would like to make that possible. That's on the list.
It's getting much, much better.
And out of curiosity, what kind of a curve fitting are you using?
Oh, here I think this is really a polynomial spline and of arbitrary degree. So I also have to implement cubic splines. I think I will. At a certain point, when I come back to this code, one of the first things I actually will do is add cubic splines instead of the splines that I use now.
Why do you need to implement those instead of using some like cube libraries?
Well, in any way, the main problem here is not as much the curves that you use, but the interface to them. So basically, if you use cubic splines or Bezier curves, you often specify gradients, for instance, and I need a new interface because now currently all the things are just points, so just specifying gradients, it's a different interface, right? So you just have to do more things to make that work.
How are these figures stored internally, and can you?
Yeah, so I can show that.
One is that and the other one is
can code. So here you have the code.
Yeah, that's the code.
So you can copy and paste, yeah. So you can just take one bit of a figure and paste it as another one.
Oh yeah, you can copy and paste things too. If I take this thing, you can... how did that work? I of course have to... Oh no, this is not... how did I select? I probably just have to... Do the same thing again. I select something, right? And then I do copy. That's copy, right? And then I do paste. And now hopefully if I can move the second one, right?
No, I mean between figures, but it's okay.
Oh, with figures it's the same idea, right? And another nice thing actually, another nice thing is that you can still also, well, we had grouped this thing, but let me ungroup it again. Okay.
So remember the properties of grouping.
Sure. Okay, make it a bit smaller. Another interesting thing is that if I go back, this one is too small. I cannot put my cursor directly inside, so I will select math mode and of course this one won't work, right? So another interesting thing is that you can move the cursor directly from the different nodes. So if you're doing diagrams here, it recognizes which parts were text fields and which parts were So inside the figure here, I can just move around between the different with the arrow keys.
It is following the tree structure of the data.
The graphical structure as well.
Okay.
So basically, when you move from one node to another one, how does it help know to go from A to B or to C?
I just go right with my cursor. If I'm at the right hand side of A, it will see that basically the next text which occurs on the right, it's beyond the arrow, and it will just jump to it. That's the way it works. In a similar way, if I'm here in text and I go up, I won't go into the figure directly. I will just go past the right. This is still all these structured properties, which is another illustration of how this structure is being used.
How would you select within the image just a diagram?
I don't know. Remember if this is the most efficient way which I used, but the idea, one idea is that you go to one of these grouping constructs, and then with the right mouse button you can select a part. So yeah, so maybe for instance, maybe I don't know, this part for instance, right? And then you can operate on it. So you can move the thing around, right? You can, and you can rotate or resize. And
I see.
So first you select the operation, and then you select the object.
Yeah.
That's kind of contrary to every other graphics program.
Well, XFIG did like that. XFIG, which is not maybe the best example, that it worked like that. Yeah. So this is just plus and minus, you can zoom.
Is it possible to keep the size of the text the same size? If you want to have a little square,
Well, you can, no, if you zoom, it's zoom, right? It's not, it's acting like a zoom. But what you can do is inside the text, you can of course inside your text do something like small a, for instance. That's possible.
How does that? Can I say a particular point size and then under zoom retain that point size?
Possibly so. I have to check. I think you can. If you really want to do this, you probably can. But I have to. Let me see. In previous version, this it worked like that. But I didn't like it because it didn't really zoom. And zoom by default should really zoom. Not. So I probably.
This is a case where interactive use and publishing use.
Yeah. So may what?
Be different.
Right.
For interactive, you really do want to zoom in and out, but for publishing, we'd like to say.
Yeah. So
it's a big X.
Yeah. Right. So I have to check this. I mean, you're not supposed as an author to inside. I mean, to use many font sizes, right? So basically, you may. Why do you use a zoom? Usually, you use zoom just in order to momentarily, if you're drawing a difficult part of your picture to see it a bit more clearer and then zoom back again to the original size.
So that's one kind of zoom, but there's a second kind, which is if you are changing the layout of your document and let's say the column width or page widths differ and you want the figure to be the full width of the column setting.
Oh, but that is already the case here. Because the width of my picture here is exactly one paragraph width.
Okay.
But so if I change that thing, let me check how it works. This one, that kind of width change does not change the size of my fonts inside. Okay, I can do that. You can even do something nicer, which is crop. Now it will crop exactly to the extent of the picture.
Let me give you the reason why I want like this kind of thing for future. Because in fact, when I write documents for my students, I really I don't want to waste space. So from time to time, I have to write in two columns, and my drawing is a little too large. So if I want to do a minus or to zoom out, so the drawing can fit in the page.
I see. Okay. I see. So then you would still like to have the same font size, but to resize the picture. Okay. Good. Okay. I understand the issue. So let me continue. Next point is hyperlinks. So Techmax of course has facilities for numbering equations and theorems. So and then we can insert a label for this theorem, so that can be done from this menu here. So a label, and later on. So I'm still in this mode where we can see where we have the document view with the detailed informative flags. So you see these flags here, which indicate where I put my labels. And later on, I can by theorem this thing, I can put a reference. I also have some tab completion here. So if you type the M and then do tab, it will complete into the name of your thing. And these things are active. So if you click on the one here, you go to the one which was there, right? And similarly, if I make a label here, I can do the same thing and jump. And if I have these navigation items here for going back in the history of the hyperlinking things, right? And of course these things can, we also have real hyperlinks, so for this, to show this, I of course would have to save my document. So for instance, I can let me put this in where did I wanted to put that demo, right? Demo. So here I save the file. I start the second file, which I also save. Didn't take the same. So let me put some stuff there too. And we can make an equation here. Okay, I save this document. I go back to the first one. We can also make a hyperlink And so I will have to put the name of the document, and then like in HTML, I put this thing there. I don't know, I think it, I named it like that. Here I don't have tab completion. And in principle, this should work, right?
Completion of the references, because when you type a space and you type tab to complete, it's actually made the non-breaking.
Yeah, but you shouldn't put the spaces inside names of labels.
Okay, then it should be more.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right, probably. But that's okay, so.
I didn't know that actually.
And, well, later on we will see another kind of hyperlinks, which are really actions, which are written in Scheme, but that we'll see later. So.
Can you often remove this document without adding a link? A document which is not on the computer.
Of course, there is also the possibility to go directly to a document on the web. So, for instance, let's take the Techmax website. Control X, Control F, but in Emacs mode. And then I open this thing, and if my Wi-Fi is still working, it should. This is an HTML page, of course. Mm-hmm. Now I hope that the thing basically is working, because of course this requires the web to work. Let me see if it works here. Mm-hmm. Oh.
It's not text.
Reload the page, maybe you have in the bathroom.
Yeah.
Oh gee, look at this. It got the picture. this is already magic for me, but why does my browser do it? It's in the cache, you think? Let me so I have to take a page which is which is not in the cache. Okay, yeah, so
you cannot enter the
Okay, so let me try once again.
You cannot enter the password from there.
Yeah, no, that won't work yet. So now it should work, right? Mm-hmm.
Now,
of course, it's not sure even. Yeah, it did work.
You can go to the menu and say file open.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that it didn't work.
And then just put the URL.
Oh, it didn't like it. I don't know why. I can get this user password.
No, I think it's the current application.
Okay. Two different pages. For me, it doesn't work. It happens.
It's a pity, because I wanted to show you something else in which is similar. Let me open my home page. Let's see.
If I want to open a remote document, I have to create a hyperlink.
Oh, this one worked. Look at that. So here I opened my own page. I don't know why this other one didn't work. It usually works, but as you see, so here the thing, maybe it was cached. Yeah, of course it was cached. Of course the thing was cached. That's the reason. Okay. Right. Okay. Yeah. Oh, you also said the same thing, right? Techmax. Yeah, but I didn't understand that Techmax also caches things. I forgot that. Okay, so here you, yeah, of course the page is, well, not as nice as, well, of course, unfortunately, it's not as nice as the browser would do it, because it doesn't understand CSS in the same way as, but you get something, right? I mean, if the HTML is basic enough, then it will open up well.
Is there any way to do that to have a figure being like floating so that the text wraps around there?
No, not. You can do it with table. I would do it with a table. But wait a minute. I wanted just to answer this previous question about remote documents. Here I opened an HTML remote document, but you can also open Tecmax remote document. So if the remote document was just a Tecmax file, it would open up nicely. Okay, so you can also use that. Whatever you put, it will just, if there's HTTP in front of it, it will load like a normal file with the same extension, with the same conventions.
You need to be in Emacs mode.
No. The Emacs mode was just for getting a Control X, Control F, and typing in something here.
But in the Mac, the default dialog, you don't have possibility.
Yeah, right. That's the QT port, which is a bit different. So.
What if you would like to put the hyperlink to a web page that you can to load into text? Would you scan the browser?
Yeah, but then this is not really a hyperlink then. That would be rather what I call an action, which fires some external command, which could be an arbitrary command, but also with certain safety risks. So I will show that later. But let me go on to our last interesting, feature, except from the computer algebra sessions things, which is presentations. So if you want to make a laptop presentation, like what we're doing here, but with more mathematics inside, then you can go to select the Beamer style, and you will get something like that. You may prefer some other Beamer packages. You may take a metal look, for instance, if you prefer that. Massimiliano prefers this one, I guess. So then basically a laptop presentation is made up from several screens that you will show in succession. So I insert a screen stack. So now I'm at slide one, as you can see. And then I can insert a title. So I can start writing a presentation. So the idea of presentations, of course, is that you, at a certain point, view them like this. Okay. Full screen. And I can, this is strange. What's going on here? Is this QT what does this? I can add new, you see this, Massimiliano? This strange line here? Oh, now it's gone. Oh, now it's back again. That's QT. There are bugs in QT. Okay. So if we have a second slide, let's see, outline. Right. You see these buttons here. We can move it in the presentation. So we can go back, can go forth, and of course we also have keyboard shortcuts for this. So these are the F9 until F12 keys. So F10 goes back, F11 goes forth, like that. And if you happen to have a remote control, you can also use the remote control to go forth and to go back. You may sometimes have to, for the remote control to work, to activate the remote control here. There are different types of remote controls. So you for the typical Mac remote control, it should just work out of the box. But some other remote controls work with keyboard simulation. So then basically, let's say enter would mean go to the next slide. So I just remap the keyboard, and for this keyboard remapping to be activated, you have to, in view, to activate the remote control here. So typical content that you might want to put in presentations is that you, for instance, that we want to unroll something. So we do something like that. Then I can insert next line, and again a next line, and again a next line. And then if we look how this presents, then you see that when going back and forth, that this is being unrolled. Another thing you can use is a switch. So if I put a switch, then typically this is just going to be displayed in succession. And this, of course, can be, as you see here, it can be nested. So it's structured again, right?
Can switches take less than a line?
Huh?
Can switches take less than a line? If you have, for example, a sum.
Yeah, right. So if you, for things which, for instance, inside the math formula, I can take a tiny switch in that case. And then, for instance, the first one is alpha plus beta. And then, let's say x plus y, and then say I don't know, right? And then this also works in the same way. And so we're going to the screen stack again. So there are, for this mode, there are also some additional decorations that you may want to use. Like, for instance, things like that. If you want to put a theorem nicely highlighted, for instance, then you could do something like that. Okay. And you can also use some other animations. So, for instance, some animation which will run like that. Okay. If this amuses you.
Export this to a PDF for the website.
That's less nice. You can do it, but of course some of the information is getting lost when you do this.
Is it just like the last slide for each screen?
Well, it depends. The unroll will, for instance, completely unroll the thing. For some of the switches, I think it just superposes them or juxtaposes them for this. Active kind of things, it just forgets to move, right? So it depends. Maybe I should make it more customizable for how to export these things.
The problem is that we go through PostScript always, so there is no direction. We don't and have any direct conversion to PDF.
Right.
We don't have any meme. Even in the PDF, you have something for a presentation. We don't have any meme.
And here you have some hyperlinks works 90%. Some of the hyperlinks are not conserved, but most of them are. Here I put another tag inside, which was repeat. So the action of some of the the thing, I repeated it. And of course, you can just copy and paste these things, right? So if you want to have more of these things inside your document.
What happens if you call that story?
Oh, that would be pretty bad. I will save it first before even trying. Let's see. Let's see what happens. I think this will be pretty bad. Yeah. You basically. I mean, some of these tags just are not defined anymore, as you see. Well, I can still go more or less inside, but it's just not very nice, right? It's just not very nice. Of course, what on the other hand, I can remove the beamer, or this other package, right? And then you get another look and feel of this thing. And here, of course, I can still do also structured variants. So if you want just to switch to something nice here,
can you flatten the folds? Can you tell?
Yeah, so there are different options here. So you have to look a bit. Yeah, so here you see you have several things. You can fold everybody, unfold everybody, compress, expand. I'm not going to do this now, but we can discuss this thing. So the last thing, and of course, once again, with Control F9 on my laptop, you have the full screen variant of this thing. And for us, also, by the way, a particularly nice application of all this is the interactive sessions. So that was also precisely the next point that I wanted to show. So we have also already seen the Maxima system before. So now I launch it inside the presentation. So we can differentiate. Some things. Integrate. Right, and of course, this can, if you now use it inside the presentation, it will fold and unfold like that. You can also click on it if you want to specify which things get folded or unfolded. You can even make sub sessions, so like this here, right? And then another subsession and things like that, and again these things get folded, unfolded like that, and you can of course use them interactively. One of the advantages, of course, of using TechMax for presentations is that if you had an error on your slides, you can correct them. So I wanted to put a 3 here. Well, I just put the 3 here. Right, it's again, it's an active document, and so let's another way, interesting way for using computer algebra, which was asked at the end of Andre's talk, is to use a scripting language. I can use, for instance, Maxima as a scripting language. So when I do this, you see that here some Maxima menu pops up. So I can use Maxima in the background while writing some things. So for instance, compute, let's say 1 plus 1. And when I'm inside the formula and I press control return, then basically the current formula will be passed to maxima and evaluated. Okay. And this is not a fault in this case. Okay, so this is just operating on my formula directly. You can also, for instance, ask maxima, well, let's say that we want to differentiate something. So we take this thing, we press differentiate. We have to specify with respect to what. I press enter, and there we are. Okay. And so let me see. Let me show now another one. So let's say that we take a matrix like here. We are going to say that we want to keep the evaluated expressions. I have this matrix, and we are going to do some linear algebra. We are going to invert this matrix. And there you see that on the left-hand side, we show the input expression, which is kept. In this case, and at the right-hand side, we now have the output expression. So I can invert it once more. Okay, so then we get something like this. And then I can ask maxima to simplify this thing. And then we got, well, so what we expect.
The function of the head. And the function that's applied doesn't depend on the first position, it's just goes at the head of the left hand side.
It takes the current expression on which we're operating. So this is the equation we're in, or the formula we're in. But we can also, if we want so, select something and then ask maxima, well, I will deselect this thing then to operate on a part of the formula, and that will also work. Okay.
How do current support for more computer algebra systems? Suppose I want to do the same thing for linears. Where could I add stuff?
Basically, you mainly want to you have to tell basically that reduce is going to be a scripting language. At the moment that you configure your plugin, you have to tell this. Then you have to, well, you usually want to make a nice reduce menu where the features of reduce are going to be advertised, like the maxima menu here. One other important thing is that the output that reduce is going to send back to TechMax should be uncluttered. By this I mean that if you run maxima inside a session, like here, the output, there is some stuff here, right? Like the output prompt and some in LDOR or in FreeCAS, you would typically have the type which is being displayed and things like that. So basically you would have to implement a routine which removes all this clutter. And if you do that, then basically you will just be able to use it as a scripting language. And there are some scripting languages which are actually, I think we will see this tomorrow, I guess, which are used really to take some LaTeX code to process it and for displaying some special kinds of pictures. So this can also be used in order to compute certain pictures with the tag that you already showed, the default executable thing here. So these, many of these, like xypic, for instance, findmf, dratec, all these things are used for computing pictures, which will then be inserted in your text. So that's more or less it. So I will end with a few editing facilities. So one of the main features of TechMax, of course, is that it's a WYSIWYG system, fully WYSIWYG system. So if you just say print, then you will get what you see on your screen. And if I see preview, it will convert my document to PDF. Did it show? What's going on? Is it running? What's going on? There is something strange going on. Who is working here? Oh, here it is. I don't know what happens. Is it Maxima which is still doing something? I don't know why my... Oh, it's maybe... it's QuickTime maybe, which is... So here you see that the transparency was not exported. Right? So... Okay, so that works. You have already seen the search and replace, which is context sensitive. Import and export, we will talk much more about LaTeX import and export later on. One interesting import facility that I do want to show right now is HTML import. Oh, there we go again. This is really irritating. So if you go to Wikipedia, you have some nice explanations on Stirling's formula. So I can take this Wikipedia page. Oh, did I get it fully? Oh, there's no HTTP in front of it anymore.
It's
Chrome.
Why don't I have HTTP in front? But it's still there. Oh, this is a new thing. Oh yes, it is there. Okay, good. So I can search this space. I hope that I don't get this fallacia thing now. Yeah, right. So here, this shows how Wikipedia is imported. And what you see here, the interesting thing is what you did not see in your browser. These are pictures, right? But here you can take the formulas and you see the formulas. And this here, I exploit a special feature of Wikipedia, which is that all the images are annotated by the original LaTeX. So I basically use the LaTeX import here for getting the pictures. And it would be nice to further improve the HTML importer. As you see, CSS, for instance, is not well supported, so I don't get the nice thing that you see here. There are some strange things also from time to time. For instance, mathematical formulas are not consistently written with LaTeX, for instance. Sometimes some other things happen, and here you see an example. What would be really nice is if we were able to handle some of the forms in HTML. So that would be a nice extension if someone would like to work on converters too, that if I push edit here, that basically I can really So here it, well, it says that I'm not logged in, okay, but that I could really edit these Wikipedia pages with TechMax, right? So with the real math formulas inside. And the very last editing feature that I wanted to show is the spell checking. So for, well, normal languages, so I will have to go back to the paper with Grégoire. So here we are back in our paper. So I can run the spell checker. So, okay, so this it didn't like. So there are some things. So you can accept, replace, insert in your dictionary the things which were not found, right? And so there's spell checking. What is more interesting is that there is also some math checking. So as I said, we have now this new parser for parsing the formulas which are inside your document, which you can also, of course, use just to check that the formulas in your document are syntactically correct. So this can be done by taking the math check utility. And here you see some of the formulas here which are correct and some other ones which are not. So the ones which are not correct, which could not be parsed, are inside these boxes here. And I can make them correct. So this was not correct because the test here basically is text. And text is considered as being something empty, which basically should be ignored. So of course, if I put in plus at the end of my thing, well, there's a missing argument here. So if I insert this missing argument, then it will be understood.
And maybe text should be a symbol whose context is the text.
Right. So another thing you could do is, if you're not happy with the way that this was understood, you just select this thing, and in the you have some annotation here, and you can say what you intended as the meaning. So if I want to consider this as an ordinary symbol, something which should be interpreted in the same way as, say, X, then I just annotate it in that way, and now it will be understood in the way. So maybe I will have some time to discuss more this new syntactic, this semantic editing things, how it works.
For the Wikipedia pages, because they use a very specific subset of LaTeX, it's not full text, that might be an interesting target, just to say that kind of text should be totally supported. It's a well-defined scope.
Right. Well, you heard that, François?
I would like to add something on that, because when I suggested this feature to you of taking the math from
right.
Wikipedia, I said that maybe it's also interesting if one could it's social work, it's not coding work, but convince the Wikipedia guys to make the printable version go through TechMax, because that would give a lot of publicity to the project.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, you can use math checks on Wikipedia, so you don't really, it's not so ugly, so why would you use it?
Oh, you mean the print in paper?
No, when they produce printable versions in Wikipedia,
okay.
It used to be the Hideous, and I think they will do some very, very horrible hack to get it working on the LaTeX, and then it will be less Hideous. But even better is if for a modifiable source, if you would get a TechMax document, you could edit before you print. And it would be a very beautiful, it's done beautifully, it's almost all ingredients are there. If it's done beautifully, it would be a super publicity for
good luck fighting with 100 committees and
thousand
people.
You can do it as a service on an external page, and then they will decide to incorporate it once they see how cool it is.
You heard that too?
This thing relies on the alt tag, on the alt
right.
images, right? So
right.
When you got math checks enabled in Wikipedia, when you got no images, it wouldn't work, right?
you could just take the text and $2. And, you know, you can enable map text in Wikipedia. Define a custom CSS in your user profile, and then you see map text. So the pages are rendered with map text code between
dollars. I see.
So maybe that should be changed in order to be able to get the text.
Well, I mean, I just take the annotations from the formulas, mm-hmm. and that seems to work, actually.
It wouldn't. Oh, because you're not logging in, of course. You're just accessing the
Yeah,
you're not logging in to Wikipedia.
Yeah.
So it's like you're at the stage where you could almost, when you go to edit a Wikipedia page, to actually edit it directly in TechMax and then save it back.
Yeah, in principle, that could be done. The only point is that we don't support forms for HTML. So basically, there are two things which should be done for making this to work. First is that it should support this informal marking, markup language which is used everywhere in Wikipedia. So that's the first part. The second part is that we have to have forms.
I'm thinking of something a little bit different. Rather than just take the ugly editing through lots of work by supporting forms and to be able to do ugly editing in an HTML simulator inside of TechMax. That's not what I'm suggesting. I'm suggesting instead that there's to take HTML, which is coming from Wikipedia edit page, which is in a very stylized form,
mm-hmm.
and then convert that internal to a TechMax document,
mm-hmm.
and not to be an HTML form. So mm-hmm. then one edits the Wikipedia mm-hmm. page like it was a TechMax document.
Mm-hmm.
And then one saves it, and then that just sends back the...
That would be better, even. Sure.
That's something which might be enough different from what's there already that people would like it.
Yeah. That was my original wish, actually, for having a TechMax wiki, that it would work. And at a certain point, it actually exactly worked like that until we had these server problems that I've already mentioned before.
So that maybe the actual data storage format is just the uglified Wikipedia representation.
Yeah.
Even though it's really a TechMax document, it's compiled
yeah.
in the ugly.
Yeah, right. Well, I see one potential problem with this strategy in the way that Wikipedia works is that the sections are edited individually. So I can edit, for instance, just this part, or edit just this part, or edit just this part. So if I would take the Wikipedia page and just start modifying whatever in the document and then push save, it should save all the parts.
No, you can edit everything at once by clicking in the link at the very
this one. Ah, right. Oh, good.
And we never would see this. We would just...
Right, we would never see that. Exactly, of course. Sure. You're absolutely right. That would be the best. I mean, that it would just work like saving a document. I mean, that's how it should work, right? Instead of all these forms and things and I agree. I totally agree. Right. Okay. So, thank you. I think, it was a bit longer than planned, everything. But I hope, next, of course, we went through the more general part now. So there are lots of interesting comments and so, and that I will. I have nice new ideas too.
That's not the speaker.
Uh-huh.